This recording is protected by copyright. No part may be reproduced without the prior permission of the University of South Australia.
Hi everyone. How are you? All right. Are your brains all full already? I'll try not to fire too much information at you. Thanks for the kind introduction. So I work at the Centre for Sleep Research, and we do a mixture of basic research in the laboratory where we get usually young, healthy people, and then we put them in our time isolation lab and we work out what happens to their biology and their psychology when they're sleep deprived. We put them on different sleep schedules at different times of day for different numbers of days, and then we go out into the field and work out whether that basic research applies and how it applies in the field, mostly, as was said in the introduction, with shift workers. So we do a lot of work with train drivers, truck drivers, nurses, pilots, doctors, trying to work out how much sleep they get relative to their work schedules, and then whether they're safe and healthy and productive at work, and how to make those things better for people in their work lives. And so we do a very big mix of research, and it ranges from basic to applied, and it also is very interdisciplinary. So we have colleagues that we work with very closely that are trained in psychology like I am, but also work with physiologists and nutritionists and people in medicine and genetics to try and help answer the questions that we're interested in. And so that means that there's a large number of journals that we could choose to publish in, and we have a large number of audiences that we could target with our work. And so the journals I publish in range from everything from basic psychology, neuroscience and medicine, all the way through to ergonomics and human factors and aviation and space. So I think for my particular situation, there is a lot of choice and a lot of consideration that we can make when we're thinking about where we're going to put our work. And so I'll just really talk to you a bit about the decision-making process that I go through, and then just give you a few examples from papers I've authored. And so I've been asked to talk about publishing with impact. So I'll try and give some examples of papers where I think there's actually been some kind of outcome, either for me personally or for industry, hopefully both usually. And so the first thing to do when we think about where we're going to publish is to think about who our audience is. That's really important. And so for me, I'm choosing often between a basic scientific audience in a particular domain, potentially an industry audience. And so those are important choices because they affect the way that the whole paper is written. And writing papers is really storytelling. I mean, what you're trying to do is take the reader on a journey, tell them a story, and then provide them with evidence for the way that you have told your story. Hopefully they'll be convinced by it. And usually that evidence is in the form of the data that you've collected. And so you choose your spin and story. And so for me, that is usually choosing between whether I want to go back in the literature and talk about our basic understanding of how things work and how that's going to be forwarded by the research I'm about to present, or start with an industry problem that we need to answer and tell the story about how this research helps answer that problem. And then that also impacts on the language that you use, and I've said languages because it's not just whether you are communicating in English or German, that we have very specific domain-specific languages that we use to communicate in research. So, for example, for me, in sleep research, I could say that we did a particular intervention and the polysomnographically defined sleep parameters had EEG changes that were indicative of increased homeostatic load. So I could say that to a sleep audience, and I see a lot of blank faces around the room, and that's perfectly understandable. If I was communicating that to an industry audience, all I would have to say is, when we measured their sleep, it showed that they were sleepier. So we talk in very different ways, and the scientific language that we use is important because it communicates very specific changes that we understand within our particular domains, but means nothing to people outside of our specific areas. And so we have to think about what language we're going to use. And we also have to think of the language of communication of our data. So if we're publishing in quantitative research, then we might look at how the field chooses its statistical analyses, which ones it chooses, which statistics it reports. If we're working in qualitative fields, we might choose whether we have a particular, you know, orientation, methodology, lens that we would talk in, and whether that fits with the journal and the audience. And so thinking about spin, story, language, and also tone. So am I coming at this from the perspective of someone who's an expert in science, in the industry, in both? Someone who's proposing an answer to a problem? Am I coming from the perspective of someone who's giving a call to arms for a really important future research area that we need to focus on? So we think about audience and we think about all these things, and that can affects the core of the way that we approach writing the paper in the first place. So the idea of just putting together a summary of your results and then just choosing the journal with the highest impact factor, I think, is a little bit of a simplification of the story. So then you need to think about, if you're interested in what you're going to do with your science, you need to think about the journal and the network that the journal is breaking you into. So think about who reads the journal, who has access to it, which is important, and you've already heard about open access. So if I'm publishing some scientific findings, I might be quite comfortable with the fact that only people with university licenses can afford to get a hold of my article, whereas if I've got something that's much more relevant for community or industry, that might be a concern, and I might be much more likely to pay the extra money to get my journal article open access so that someone in a hospital can get access to it if they don't have a university affiliation, so that a teacher can read it in a school, those kinds of things. Looking at who publishes in the journal, because if they publish in it, they probably read it, and so that will give you an idea of which of your colleagues support that journal and who will see your name connected with the research that you're putting out. Definitely look at the editorial board and who is on the editorial board. Who are the editors particularly and the sub-editors? If they have anything to do with your field and you've written an article and you haven't cited them, then that's bad. So find what they've done. Put it in your article somehow, and if you possibly can, talk about it in a very nice way. And same with the reviewers and the whole editorial board. Think about connecting with them and say, you know, hey, I know you, you do good things, I'm your colleague, and they'll be much more likely to publish you. And then also look at the society affiliations of journals. So often they're, you know, the official journal for the Chronobiology Society or the official journal for the Medical Society of Australia or something. And that's really important because society membership journals give you an entree into a group of people that are very interested and often meet together and talk about things. They also can get you an entree into presenting at the conferences that happen as a result of those societies. And I'll talk about some examples of where publishing in journals with society affiliations has really helped me in different ways in my personal and professional networking. Conference special editions are really good because it probably means that everybody who went to the conference is going to read your paper. Then, of course, think about the impact factor, other citation information, and then look at other things that I'm sure you've already been talking about, like submission and rejection rates and subscription rates, and for open access journals, maybe downloads as well. It's a very useful indicator, and perhaps may be becoming more increasingly more useful over and above just how often the work is cited. So then think about fit for your work. So every journal on its journal web page will have a scoping statement, and if the scoping statement doesn't sound like the kind of stuff you're doing, then more than likely if you send your work there, you'll get a really nice letter from the editor, usually within 24 hours, saying this isn't a really good fit, or consider sending this somewhere else. Have a look at manuscript types. So some journals will, for example, accept narrative reviews. Some will only accept systematic reviews. So if you have written a piece of work that suits a narrative style more than a systematic style, then that journal's not for you. Some journals will only publish full research papers. Others will allow you to have short articles. Others will have fast review. So that's really useful if you've got something that's really hot and you think one of your colleagues might be about to publish very soon, or if you're about to put in an application for a grant and you really want something published before you put your grant in. So those are really important, and other things like case studies and so forth. So manuscript types that journals have can often give you a clue as to whether your work will fit with them. And then also think about the scientific merit of your work, whether you're pitching it at a scientific audience, whether the big advances are in theory, in understanding, or whether they're actually applied, in which case should you be targeting an applied audience or a journal that allows you to have scientific and industry readership, for example. Think about school of thought. So for me, I'm a quantitative researcher. I deal primarily in numbers. And so I wouldn't probably very often publish in a journal of sociology, for example, or one that had a more phenomenological focus. And I will publish in journals that are used to seeing the type of methodologies I use, because then you require less explanation and less review in the methodology, and you're also getting more likely to get people reading it to use the same approaches as you, and so then you're more likely to contribute to converging evidence around that approach. So I think about all of those kinds of things, and then I'll just show you some examples of what some of the particular papers I've been involved with, what the outcomes of those papers have been. So we did this study a few years ago now, where we had a particular device that measured skin conductance in people using a ring and a wrist device. And the idea was that this particular device was supposed to measure alertness. And some operators within the Australian industry, Australian rail industry, were considering putting this device in their trains to help maintain alertness in their drivers. So we did a study with a device and we found absolutely no results. So we basically found, and that's not said in this paper because it's written in a very diplomatic way, that it was really pretty much a random signal generator from what we could tell. So it wasn't very helpful. And the device itself hadn't been very well validated before, hadn't been published before, and each unit cost more than €6,000. And so that's a very, very substantial cost when you're considering putting it in multiple train cabs across the Australian rail industry. And so we did this study, and then we had a bit of trouble because we had null findings, and everybody knows it's very difficult to publish null findings. And so we had to think about where we were going to publish it. The obvious place would have been an industry journal, except if we did that, then it wouldn't have had as high a profile. And we needed it to be strong enough so that the people who are making the decisions about whether to implement this device in industry in Australia would be convinced by it. And so we sent it to Behaviour Research Methods, which is actually a scientific journal about methodologies. And we did that deliberately so that it would have a higher academic standing. And then we had to go through the process of arguing with the editor that actually it was really important to publish this null finding. It's not that surprising, but it could have implications for people who are considering choosing the device. And so we got it published, and the people that made the device were really mad, but thankfully the rail industry didn't take it on. So we stopped them from wasting a whole bunch of money and hopefully kept people a bit safer as a result. So that was really important. So I guess that shows that your work can do things. So think about what you want your work to actually do. Because if you can change things by your work, then that's the absolute best case scenario. And so this one was a sort of a similar study, but this was done looking at train driving in a train simulator. And so we chose to publish this one in a journal called Applied Ergonomics, which is more of an industry bent journal. And the person who was the editor at the time of the journal was also in charge of Human Factors and Ergonomics Society. And so when they read this paper, when it came across their desk, they decided that that would be a good paper to present at their conference. And so I got a plenary on the basis of this paper, which was fantastic, which helped me make contacts and colleagues in a new society that I wasn't a member of yet. So thinking again, this is an example of thinking about who's on the editorial board, who the editors are, what they're connected with, and the societies that the journal is connected with, and can be very, very useful. This was a study that we did in real trains, and we were getting the black boxes from the trains, like they have in aeroplanes, and these black boxes record everything that's happening multiple times a second, so we're looking at, you know, fuel use and braking and throttle use and speed. and position on the track. And so what we found was that when we looked at fatigued drivers in trains and we compared them to drivers who were at a low level of fatigue based on their prior work history, then drivers who were fatigued used 9% more fuel. So for these trains on these that run on this track twice a day, just for this corridor, this much extra fuel, conservatively estimating fuel cost at about $1 a litre, meant that this was costing the railway sort of for this, just with this one corridor, an extra $180,000 a year in fuel just for this track. And so this was really interesting for us, and we wanted it to have an impact on the way that the rail industry made their decisions about working and fatigue levels of their drivers. And transport is a very progressive industry, actually, in the way it manages fatigue anyway. And so we published that one in Journal of Sleep Research, which is actually a very basic science-type journal, but it has both a scientific and industry audience. And that worked out really well because then I got invited to go and do workshops with Safe Work SA and do stuff for Safe Work Week and Business Week, as well as go and present at other industry forums that were interested in fatigue in rail and transportation. And so that actually got me connected with a whole lot of other groups, and that was very, very useful and very rewarding, and I'm still working with a lot of those people today. So then just to underline the example of the society-affiliated journal, so we had, I'm a member of the Working Time Society, which is a fantastic international society that looks at working time and the impact of irregular and long working hours across the world. And so every year, or every 2 years, we meet in some awesome location around the world and we talk about working time, and it's fantastic. And also every 2 years we have a special edition of a few journals and we publish based on those conferences. And so two conferences in a row I published a study that we've been going on with in looking at fatigue and errors in nurses. So we published the pilot study in the first special edition, and then the second opportunity rocked round and we published the updated version. And the person who's now the president of the Working Time Society noticed these articles, and on the basis of that she invited me to come to Spain to present at Chronobiology Society conference. So we had a plenary there, and she's also the editor of a journal, the Brazilian Journal of Public Health. So then on the basis of that, I was able to publish this follow-up study in her journal, which was extra cool because it means I got an abstract which is in English but also Portuguese, which is amazing. I don't know what it says. I hope it says the same thing, but it's still still pretty exciting. So trying to get volume is really hard in publishing, and one of the main reasons is because we've got deadlines for everything except our papers. So we have deadlines for grants and teaching, and everything has to keep ticking over, and then we don't have time to, you know, sit down and have the really important, intense thought processes that you need to come up with something really well crafted so that you can submit your article. But there's lots of different strategies that I've used with my colleagues over the years that actually really help. One is to review more, because if you review more, you know what's going on in the field, and you also pick out issues in papers a lot more quickly, and it makes you a better writer and it makes your editing process much quicker for yourself. And so someone was telling me, can't remember when, in the last few days, that writing is two processes. It's putting ideas out there and then it's critiquing them. And so you really need to have your brain practicing both of those processes. So reviewing helps you practice being a good critic. And I can't recommend enough how useful that is. Making connections is good because then you know the people that you're submitting your work to. It can help you target better, and then you can also plan that your submissions of your work can also help build those connections, which is really important. Get to know the different camps in your field. So if you know that there's a specific area in your field that prefers this type of methodology but isn't so keen on another, but there's this other camp that really loves the other methodology and isn't so keen on the first one, then you can, in knowing those camps and in knowing those schools of thought, you can target your work so that it fits where it's going to be most appreciated and valued, or you can target at the opposite camp and try and shake things up a bit if you're brave. Writing in teams is really helpful. It's not the norm in all scientific spheres, but it certainly is in sleep research because we do sleep studies, we study people 24 hours a day, and there's no way you can do that with just one person. So all of our studies are large and expensive and take teams, and so we write in teams, which is really great. So normally from a study, we will have multiple outcomes, and each person that's involved on the team will have their own particular research question they're asking. So that means that we'll co-author a battery of papers from a single study, which works well for all of our CVs. Of course, teamwork isn't always easy, so when you find good teammates and you can work really well in that kind of context, then hold on to them because they're like gold. I'll probably come back to that in a second. Have a publication portfolio and a long-term plan. So monitor how many papers you've got under consideration and in press in any one time, and try and have a target. So I usually try and have, you know, 6 to 10 publications, not all sole authored by me, by the way, but as you know, part of the team that I'm in, under review at any one time, which means that there will always be publications coming out. To try and avoid those gaps in your CV when, especially in social sciences, like psychology, where the studies take a very long time to do, and then they take a very long time to analyse, and then the journals take often quite a while to actually publish the work. So it's not a fast-moving field like perhaps some of the more medical sciences are. So you just have to plan for that. Get involved in publications with deadlines. So that's why publications for special editions following conferences are really useful, because you've got a hard deadline. So you'll write to it and you actually get the publication out. Consider all aspects of your work as potential opportunities for publication. So I've worked with my third year students from my health psych class to write papers. Basically anything that I write, whether it's for industry or as part of my basic research program, I try and get some sort of publication out of it. And then the other thing which is cool that I've done before is go on publication retreats. And so, for example, we had a trip to the APY lands where we all took our laptops and we went to the most fabulous, beautiful, inspiring place in Australia, I think, and cut ourselves off from everything and soaked up the landscape and were inspired and just wrote for 4 or 5 days. And you can get a whole paper out in that time. Other times we've gone to conferences overseas and then just not come back for a week or two. The reason why that's really great is because you've told everyone you're on leave, so you're less likely to have extra jobs happening while you're away. And also you've just been to a conference, you've just talked about that piece of work, you've got all the questions that everyone in the audience asked you right in your head. You've written them all down. You're thinking about it. So you sequester yourself away. And before you start your normal life again, you write your paper and submit it before you come home. And that is really, really awesome. And I'm very grateful that I'm in a job that I can do wonderful things like that in. Now, trying to get more impact from your publications, it's really important to go on tour with what you found. So tell as many people as you can. We have an ethical requirement to publish because especially in human research and animal research, when we actually put our participants out, we place some burden on them. We have a moral obligation to actually take the work that we have from that and tell people about it so that it's the benefits outweigh the costs. And so you might get a good audience for your paper if you publish it in the right journal, but most of the time it helps to go out and tell people too. So try and go and speak about your work to lots of different audiences, go to different scientific groups, go to different industry groups, and try and, if you can, keep note of the things that the audience say to you after you've presented and the questions that they ask, because it's really important. Not only does it help you refine the message and the way you talk about your work, but it can often tell you where you need to go next. which is really, really useful. And then look at who's citing and downloading you and where they're from. Are you being cited by industry or science? Are you in policy? Are you in white papers? And now that most are finding that is a lot easier than it used to be because you can just go onto Google and search for yourself, search for your paper name and see where it pops up. And so for us, it's really nice. We can track the different industry position statements and so forth that are citing our papers. And that's really rewarding because you can see that your work is doing something. And then you also have an evidence base in your CV that your work is having an impact. Also look at what they say when they cite you. So don't just look at the citation, but look at how they describe it and what they're saying about it. And not just whether they say your work was good or not, but the interesting parts that they use from it. And that can tell you what the most important messages or the most useful messages are from your work. And that's especially important when people from industry, for example, are citing you, because as someone who doesn't work in industry and who is, in the ivory tower of the university, it's always nice to see how your work translates in real situations with real people. And also it's interesting to look at what the media is interested in. So often if you're going to conferences, you'll get media contact about your work, and thinking about the way they ask the questions and the kinds of answers they would like is often a very useful thing to do. So when you're thinking about publishing, volume is good, so having a big CV is good, but not at the expense of quality. So you have an academic voice. That's one thing we're very privileged to have when we start writing in science, is that automatically people will listen to us, and that is a privilege, but it's also a responsibility. So think about what you're saying and the fact that your work can have, and hopefully will have, impacts that can change the way people live and work. And so if you think about it in those terms, then you need to make sure that everything you put out, you have considered who the audience is and what the potential consequences are and what the potential good or bad things that could come out of your work. And so try and publish as much as you can, but always try and tell the story in the most concise and careful way that you can, that's going to have the most good impact. And then also, when you find good colleagues to write with, or colleagues, even if they're not co-authors on your papers, but if you can swap with them and get their impact, then love them, love them, love them, because that is just the best way to further your work, to further your thinking, and hopefully also help to further their work and their thinking. And I'm very, very privileged. I have a lot of wonderful colleagues that I just adore. And just as a final gratuitous plug, if anyone is considering publishing any work that they have done as students, or that they have, are working with students that they are mentoring, then we have this journal called Eat, Sleep, Work, which I'm the editor-in-chief, and we have a fabulous editorial board with people from UniSA and also University of Sydney and Melbourne. And we have a mix of early career researchers and very experienced, wonderful, inspiring people on our editorial board. So if you have some student work that might fit in a journal like this, then consider submitting it. We'd love to read it and try and help support our next generation of researchers. Thank you.